catch up with you on that.
Very good.
Hey, welcome back in. This is the Steve Gill Show. We talked with Senator Rand Paul yesterday, and one of the points he made is that he has come to the conclusion that Barack Obama really doesn't want to solve any problems in this country, that there's no real ability to negotiate or discuss anything with the guy because he really doesn't want to work a deal with the senators. And we've heard that from our senator, Bob Corker, for a long time, that you came to the conclusion early on that while Barack Obama might meet with you occasionally, he really didn't have any interest in creating jobs or working with the Republicans to do anything. I will tell you that in talking with Rand Paul yesterday, he's with you on this. Bob Corker, good to have you in with us. Yeah, are you surprised that it's taken some of your fellow senators a while to kind of figure this out? You've been telling this for about a year now.
Yeah, I mean, this is why, Steve, I've been pushing so hard for just, this is an arcane thing probably for your listening audience, but just regular order, meaning that what's happened recently is, you know, everything that's happening in the Senate is top down. It's being airdropped in, and they're behind their negotiations that are taking place behind closed doors. And when negotiations take place behind closed doors, each side can claim that they're trying to do something, and yet you never really see anything in writing. And so, you know, why haven't we passed a budget in the Senate in over 900 days? I didn't vote for any spending bills this last year, and there were things in some of these bills that, look, I strongly support, but how can you vote for spending bills when you won't go through the tough work of dealing with a budget? And so what the administration has done is, you know, all during July of this last year, quote, they were meeting at the White House, and yet we never came up with a solution that the American people had a chance to actually see. And it just seemed to me there was a lot of rope-a-dope taking place. You know, he could claim that, in fact, he was trying to come up with a deal, and yet we never heard any specifics about entitlement reform or any types of cuts to take place. So, again, what we need to do is get back to regular order. Let's deal with these issues out front in public, and let's get it done. I mean, all of us know we've got to deal with tax reform. We've got to deal with entitlement reform. We have to deal with the long-term deficit. Let's get on with it. We all know it has to happen.
But the Democrats made the decision, Harry Reid and the Democrats made the decision when they had a supermajority in the U.S. Senate. They didn't want to pass a budget because it would make them have to make some tough decisions. They would have to tell somebody no. They didn't want to do that, so we've been operating with no budget now, as you point out, for 900 days. Why don't the Republicans put up some of those big screens that literally day 932 that the Democrats failed to pass a budget in the Senate and remind everybody that, A, they control the Senate, and, B, they haven't done their job now in nearly 3 years.
What I've been trying to say to my colleagues is, why would you vote for a spending bill if we can't pass a budget? I mean, that is a sure way to, you know, you have to have 60 votes to pass these things, and that's a sure way to bring all of this to a screeching halt. So, it's been unbelievably frustrating. I actually challenged Senator Reid on the floor during this last day that we voted before we came home for the Christmas recess. Challenged him on the floor and objective to a move he was trying to make in order to press him on whether this year or not he's going to try to pass a budget. And, you know, I didn't get a satisfactory answer, but I couldn't agree more. I mean, how can we run a country? How can we deal with the country's finances? Unlike the state of Tennessee, which is already moving towards a budget this year, how can we meet the challenge of this country without doing the things we have to do? And again, people can claim that they're trying to solve problems, and yet the American people are not seeing that debate play out in public, which is what needs to happen.
As I mentioned, Senator Rand Paul, you know, pointed out yesterday when we talked with him that you also have a president who is beating up on Congress, running against a, quote, do-nothing Congress when the Democrats control the U.S. Senate. I mean, they're the ones that are sitting on 28 spending bills that are passed in the House that could reduce spending, that could address some of the issues, that could fund some of the things that they claim they want to do, and Harry Reid won't even bring it up for a vote.
Yeah. You know, the problem is, the problem for Republicans is the American people, because of all the rhetoric that's taking place at the White House, the American people believe that Congress is run by Republicans. People forget that, you know, the Senate is controlled by Democrats, and that has been a problem, and that will continue to be a problem throughout the course of this campaign.
Well, the president surely apparently has made it clear that he doesn't care if he throws the Democrats in the Senate under the bus, as long as he keeps his job. And the only job apparently he cares about in the entire country is his own job, because he's certainly not doing anything for the rest of us.
It's amazing he started campaigning as early as he did with all the issues that we have in this country. And, you know, if you look at the economic numbers that have just come out, I mean, job growth is taking place, thankfully. But it's in spite of really bad behavior in Washington, and it really shows the resilience of the private sector in this country. But there is so much that has happened in Washington over the last couple of years that really has dampened our ability to grow. I was at the Realtors Association yesterday talking about my bill, which, you know, ends Fannie and Freddie, and obviously they had some concerns about it. We had a really great discussion. And home sales are up in this area, but I look at where we could be if we'd actually embrace things that solved our country's longer problems and longer-term problems. And you know, what we've had going on now as a presidential campaign for a long time. Obviously, Tennesseans and Americans will decide the direction of this country at the ballot box, but what I hate to see happen is us wasting a year, United States Congress, not dealing with the big issues of this country. I still think there's an opportunity for us to do that, possibly in April, because I think you know that people, the sequestration process kicks in January, and a lot of people that are watching the Pentagon understand the Pentagon can't turn on a dime. So I think you know there's an additional $500 billion that is going to be cut out of the Pentagon per this Budget Control Act if we don't do something differently. $500 billion out of social programs. So there'll be some pressure mounting in April to do something, some big pressure in December when all the tax cuts go away and $4 trillion of additional taxes will be levied on the American people, by the way, in all income ranges, not just upper income. So we have some opportunities, but my guess is most of it will be squandered until after this presidential
or just pushed off after, you know, after the election and worry about it later, which is one of the reasons we have so many of the problems.
Yeah.
You mentioned the unemployment figures, and the administration is touting the slight decline that we've seen in unemployment, the new 8.5% figures, although what we were talking yesterday, that the Bureau of Labor Statistics numbers show that of the 200,000 jobs created in December, 42,000 of them were messengers and couriers. It was people delivering Christmas packages, hired short term. Do you think those numbers will go back up? Do you think the economy is really recovering, or have we just kind of hit bottom where it's not going to keep going down?
I do feel glimmers of hope, and I don't want to poo-poo. The most important thing to Tennesseans, and from a secular standpoint, is heads of households having good-paying jobs. I do feel things beginning to percolate, and I want to see that happen. I mean, I want to see good things happen for Tennesseans and Americans. So, you know, are we where we could have been had we put in place good policies in Washington over the last couple of years? No. But do I feel that the resilience of the private sector, thankfully, is beginning to take place? I do. And that's in spite of this tremendous overhang that we have from Europe, where people are concerned about, you know, financial contagion coming into this country. And that's in spite of the fact that we still have not dealt with the long-term deficits of this country. But I do feel that things are percolating. And I think, and as you know, I wake up every day. I was on the phone yesterday at length trying to put in place some policies where we deal with longer-term tax reform so that people have something consistent that they know they can count on. I mean, doing away with the loopholes, lowering everybody's rates, broadening the base, dealing with entitlement reform and long-term deficits. I believe, Steve, if we could deal with that, this economy would absolutely take off.
Well, when you look at the numbers, Newt Gingrich has pointed out in the past that if you just shift literally millions of people who are collecting unemployment payments, welfare payments, if you get them back in the job rolls and instead of collecting, they start paying taxes, you see a huge shift in the whole deficit spending issue. It all starts to turn around, but it starts with getting people back to work.
That's right. Growth cures lots of ills, and we have not had pro-growth policies in Washington for the last couple of years.
The other big frustration for a lot of folks, the Tea Party crowd and others, is that we've heard this talk about spending cuts, and they've talked about cuts in rate of growth, but we're about to go back and get another $1 trillion in debt limit increase. We're going to go back and raise the credit card limit. We're going to talk in a moment. Take a quick break. When we come back, Tennessee Senator Bob Corker with us. We'll talk about the frustration that the voters are feeling over the fact that a lot of talk about cuts, no real cuts, no seeming slowing in the rate at which we're borrowing money from the Chinese. Does he see any hope on that front? We'll be back in a moment with more of the Steve Gill Show.